out plainly.
I don't think I'm platypus, sir.
Well, I don't play accurately. Well, anybody can play accurately. But I play with wonderful expression. I've seen about the cucumber sandwiches for Augusta. I wonder who could back this order.
Mr. Earnest Worthing.
Hi, my dear Earnest. What brings you up to town?
Oh, pleasure, pleasure. Mm-hmm. Eating as usual, I see, Algie.
I believe it is customary in good society to take some slight refreshment at 5 o'clock.
Who's coming to see?
Oh, merely Aunt Augusta and Gwendolyn.
How perfectly delightful.
I don't think Aunt Augusta will approve of your being here. It's perfectly disgraceful the way you flirt with Gwendolyn. It's almost as disgraceful as the way she flirts with you.
But I'm in love with Gwendolyn, and I've come to town expressly to propose to her.
You said you'd come up with pleasure. I call it business. Please don't touch the cucumber sandwiches. They're ordered specially for Aunt Augusta.
But you've been eating them the whole time.
Oh, that is different. She's my aunt. Have some bread and butter. It's for gluten.
Very good bread and butter, this too.
Don't eat like you're ordinary to me. Not. And I don't think you will.
How do you say that?
One, girls never marry the men they flirt with. And two, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
Ernest, Cecily is my first cousin. And before... She's my first cousin. Before I let you marry her, you have to clear this whole question of Cecily.
Cecily? I'm the only one by the name of Cecily.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is the secret case you left here the last time you left. But when I look at the inscription inside, I find the name is in your skull. It's a gift from someone of the name of Cecily, and you said you know anyone of that name.
Well, if you want to know, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
But why does your aunt call herself the little Cecily with her fondest love?
My dear boy, some aunts are tall, but some aunts are not tall. I'm sure that's a matter purely for my aunt to decide for herself. For goodness sakes, give me back my cigarette, please.
Yes, but why does your aunt call you her own? Little Cecily with her fondest love to her dear Uncle Jack. Plus, your name isn't Jack, it's Ernest.
It isn't Jack, I mean, it isn't Jack, it's Ernest. I mean, it isn't Ernest, it's Jack.
But you have always said it was Ernest. You answer to the name of Ernest? I mean, you are the most earnest-looking person that I've ever seen. Here is one of your cards. It says, Mr. Ernest Worthing of the Albany. I think I'll keep this as proof that your name is Ernest.
My name is Ernest in town and Jack in the country. And that cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but this does not account for the fact that your small aunt calls you her uncle. Come on, boy. You better have out once. I've always suspected you of being secret Bunburyist, and I'm quite sure of it now.
Bunburyist? What on earth do you mean by a Bunburyist?
I will reveal the meaning of the incomparable expression as soon as you inform me about your Jack in town and Ernest in the country.
The old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Mrs. Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who just as me as her uncle, lives at my place in the country, under the charge of her admiral governor's prison. That, my dear Archie, is the whole truth. Pure and simple.
Where is that place in the country, by the way?
Well, it's nothing to you, dear boy. You're not being invited.
But why are you famous in town and Jack in the country?
When one is placed in the position of guardian, one has to adopt a very high moral tone. And that high moral tone is hardly conductive to one's health or happiness. In order to get up to town, I've always pretended to have a younger brother by the name of Ernest, who lives in the Albany, and gets the most dreadful scrapes. That, my dear Archie, is the whole truth, pure and simple.
The truth is rarely pure and ever simple. What you are is a Bunburyist. You have invented a very useful younger brother named Ernest, so that you may be able to go up to the town whenever you'd like. I, however, have invented a very invalid friend named Mr. Bunbury, so that I may be able to go down to the country whenever I'd like. If it wasn't for poor Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, I would not be able to dine with her. For I've really been engaged to Aunt Augusta for more than a week.
I haven't asked you to dine.
I know. You're absurdly curious about seeing invites. And now that I know you're confirmed with natural Bunburyist, I naturally talk about Bunburyist.
I'm not a Bunburyist at all. I mean, if Gwendolyn accepts me, then I'm gonna kill my brother.
I must be honest, Mister. If I figure out a way to be 10 minutes, I'm gonna have an opportunity to propose with Gwendolyn. Can you dine with me tonight?
Lady Bracknell and Miss Fairfax. Good afternoon, Elton. I hope you're behaving well.
I am feeling very well, Aunt Augusta.
That's not quite the same thing. In fact, the two rarely go together.
Do you mean you look nice?
I always look nice. Do I not, Mr. Vernon?
You have lovely smiles.
I'm sorry for late, Dr. Bond, but I was obliged to call into your Lady Harborough for a day. I haven't seen her since her husband's death. I've never seen a woman so altered. She looks quite 20 years younger. And now, a cup of tea with those nice cucumber sandwiches you promised me.
Good heaven, Lane. Why are there new cucumber sandwiches?
There are no cucumbers in the market this morning, sir.
No cucumbers?
No, sir. Not even for any money.
That will do, Lane. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
It really makes no matter, after all. I had some crumpets with Lady Harbour before I came, which seems to me to be living entirely with pleasure now.
I hear her hair has turned quite cold for grief. I'm afraid, Aunt Augusta, I shall have to give up the pleasure of dining with you tonight. I have had another telegram from poor Bunbury. He's very ill again.
This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Yes, poor Bunbury is a dreadful invalid.
Well, I wish he would make up his mind whether he was going to live or die. This shilly-shallying with the question is quite absurd. I would be much obliged if you could ask Mr. Bunbury not to relapse on Saturday, for I rely on you to compose my music for my last reception.
Ah, yes, the program. If you will kindly come to the next room with me, we will run the program.
Thank you. Gwendolyn, you will accompany me.
Charming day to dinner, Fairfax.
Pray don't talk about the weather, Mr. Worthing. Whenever people talk about the weather, I always feel quite certain that they mean something else.
Well, I do mean something else.
I thought so. In fact, I am never wrong.
Miss Fairfax, listen, I met you. I have admired you more than any other girl since I met you.
Yes, I'm quite well aware of the fact. For me, you always had an irresistible fascination. We live, as I hope you know, Mr. Worthing, in an age of ideals. And my ideal has always been to love someone of the name Earnest. The moment Algernon first mentioned to me that he had a friend called Earnest, I knew I was destined to love you.
You mean you couldn't love me if my name wasn't Earnest?
It is a divine name. It produces vibrations.
I can think of a lot nicer names. Jack, for instance, is a charming name.
Jack, it produces absolutely no vibrations. The only safe name is Earnest.
Well, we must get christened at once. I mean, we must get married at once.
Married? But you haven't proposed to me yet, and I think it only fits to tell you beforehand that I'm fully determined to accept you.
What?
Of course I will, darling. How long you've been about it.
Mr. Worthing! Rise up from this semi-recovered It's most indecorous.
Mama, Mr. Worthing is not quite finished yet.
Finished? What, may I ask?
I'm engaged to Mr. Worthing.
Pardon me, you're not engaged to anyone. When you do become engaged, I will inform you. And now, a few questions to Mr. Worthing. While I'm making these inquiries, you, Gwendolyn, will wait for me below in the carriage.
Mama!
The carriage, Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn, the carriage!
Yes, Mama.
May take a seat.
Thank you, Lady Brown, but I prefer standing.
Very well. Do you smoke?
Yes, I'm also glad I smoke.
Ah, I'm glad to hear it. Men should always have an occupation. Are your parents living?
I'm afraid I've lost both my parents.
To lose one parent may be regarded as a misfortune. To lose both looks like carelessness. Who's your father?
I'm afraid I'm really okay. I think it'd be near to the truth to say that my parents seem to have lost me. I was found.
Found?
Yes, Lady Bracknell. Found. Belonged to Thomas Carlyle, an elder of a very charitable disposition. Found me and gave me the name of Worthing because he happened to have a first-class ticket for Worthing in his pocket at the time. Worthing is a place in Sussex that's a seaside resort.
Where did this charitable gentleman with this first-class ticket to this seaside resort find you?
In a handbag.
A handbag?
Yes, Lady Bracknell. A large, black leather, somewhat larger than handbag with handles to it. An ordinary handbag effect.
In what locality did this Mr. Carlton find this ordinary handbag?
The cloakroom at Victoria Station was given to him in the state for his own.
The cloakroom at Victoria Station?
Yes, the right one.
The line is a material. Mr. Worthing, I confess, that's some bewildered at what you've just told me. To be born or at any rate bred in that house.
the ordinary decency.
May I ask you to invite me to do that?
I would strongly advise you, Mr. Weather, to try to acquire some relations.
But I could produce the handbag at any moment.
Sir, you could hardly imagine that I would allow my only daughter to marry into a cloakroom and form an alliance with a parcel. Good day.
Good day. For goodness sake, Sal, you don't sing that gas me too.
Didn't go off at all, boy. Not going to say Gwendolyn refused you?
No, Gwendolyn doesn't write the tricks, but her mother is perfectly embarrassed.
Did you tell Gwendolyn the truth about Anthony and Paris in town and Jack in the country?
Well, it doesn't matter at all, Gwendolyn. And by the end of the week, I should have gotten rid of Ernest. I'll say he died in Paris of apoplexy.
Apoplexy is hereditary. You might rather say a severe chill.
Very well then. My poor brother Ernest is killed off very suddenly by a severe chill. I get rid of him.
But didn't you say Miss Carter was a little too interested in your poor brother Ernest? Or won't you go a loss in good deal?
Miss Nesson's not a simply romantic girl, and she has a capital appetite, goes for long walks, and pays no attention to all her husbands.
I would rather like to see Cecily.
I'll take great care that you never do that.
Algie, kindly turn you back. I have something very particular to say to Mr. Burley.
Yes, darling?
Ernest, we may never be married. From the expression on Mama's face, I fear we never shall. But although she may prevent us from becoming man and wife, and I may marry someone else, and marry often, nothing can alter my eternal devotion to you. Your town address in the Albany I have. What is your address in the country?
The Manor House, Fulton, Hertfordshire.
The Manor House, Fulton, Hertfordshire. I will communicate daily. Algie, you may turn around. You may also ring the bell.
May I escort you out, darling?
Certainly.
Thank you. I'll be escorting Miss Fairfax out. Yes, sir.
Tomorrow, Lane, I am going to Bunbury.
Yes, sir.
I shall plan on going back to Monday. You can back all the Bunbury suits.
Oh, yes, sir.
The Manor House, Wilton, Hertfordshire.
Anything about headache?
Yes, I know that, but I felt instinctively that you had a headache.
Well, I hope, Cecily, you're not being inattentive in your studies. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would hang upon her lips. I spoke metaphorically.
Oh, I don't have a headache after all. A walk might do it some good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure.
Cecily, you will complete your political economy in my absence. The chapter on the fall of Rupi, you may omit. I believe it is somewhat too sensational.
Ernest Worthing has arrived at the station. He has brought his luggage with him.
Mr. Ernest Worthing, tell him to come here.
Yes, miss.
I've never met a wicked person before. I feel rather frightened. I'm afraid he'll look like everybody else. He does.
You are my cousin, Cecily. I am sure.
And you are my wicked cousin, Ernest.
Oh, well... I am really not wicked at all, Cousin Cecily.
Oh. Well, then you've been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner.
Of course, I have been rather reckless.
I'm glad to hear it. I'm sure it must have been very pleasant.
I'm not. That is where I want you to perform me. You might make that your mission.
I'm afraid I have no time this afternoon.
Being with you, I feel better already.
You were looking a little worse.
Well, that is because I'm hungry.
How thoughtless of me! I should remember that when one is going to lead an entirely new life, one requires regular and wholesome meals. Won't you come to the dining room?
You are the prettiest girl I ever saw.
Miss Prism says that all good looks are a snag.
A snag that any sensible man would like to be caught in.
I don't think I'd like to catch a sensible man. I shouldn't know what to talk about.
I can understand. Could pull me through. Never. You do not seem to understand that by persistently remaining single, one converts himself into a permanent public temptation.
But isn't the man not equally attractive when married?
No married man is ever attractive, except to his wife.
And often I'm told not even to her. Mr. Worthing!
Mr. Worthing?
I returned sooner than I expected.
Dear Mr. Worthing, I trust this garbled road does not betoken some terrible calamity.
It's my brother.
Still in his life of pleasure.
Dead.
Your brother, Ernest, dead?
Yes, quite dead.
What a lesson for him. I trust you will profit by it.
Poor Ernest. He had many faults, but it's a sad, sad world.
You were with him at the end?
No, he died in Paris. A severe chill.
As a man sows, so shall he reap.
Charity, dear Miss Prism, charity. None of us are perfect. I myself am peculiarly susceptible to droughts. You may no doubt wish me to make some allusion to this tragic affliction in next Sunday's sermon. The text can be adapted to almost anything, from celebrations to christenings.
Christenings? The fact is, Joe Doctor, I would like to be christened myself this afternoon.
But surely you haven't been christened already.
I don't remember anything about it.
At what hour do you wish the ceremony performed?
I might short run about 6.
Uncle Jack! Oh, I'm so pleased to see you! Oh, what horrid clothes you've got on! What is wrong? Oh, I've got such a surprise for you. Who do you think's in the dining room? Your brother?
Nonsense, I haven't got a brother.
Oh, don't say that. However badly he may behave, he is still your brother. I'll tell him to come out.
Brother Ernest in the dining room? Good heavens.
Brother John, I have come down to town to say that I'm sorry to you. And I intend to lead a better life in the future.
You are not going to refuse your brother's hand!
Nothing will induce me to take his hand.
Uncle Jack, there's some good in everybody! Ernest was just telling me about his poor invalid friend, Mr. Bunbury.
Bunbury? I won't have him talking to you about Bunbury or anything else.
If you do not shake hands with your brother, I will never forgive you.
Never forgive me?
Never, never, never!
Well, this is the last time I shall ever do it.
Is it perfect, is it not, to see so perfect a reconciliation? I think we just might leave the two brothers together.
Cecily, you will come with us.
You have done a beautiful action today, dear child.
I feel very happy.
You young scoundrel, Algie. You must get out of here as soon as possible.
I have put Mr. Earnestings in the room next to yours, sir.
What?
I'm afraid I can't stay for more than a week this time.
Ma'am, and order the dog cart back at once. I'm afraid Mr. Woodling has suddenly been called back into town.
Yes, sir. What a filthy lie you are, Jack. No one has called me.
Your duty as a gentleman calls you back.
Well, Cecily is a darling.
I won't have you talking to Miss Cuddle like that. I don't like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes. It's perfectly childish to be in deep mourning for someone who's actually going to be staying at your house for more than a week.
You are certainly not staying with me for more than a week.
I will certainly not be as long as you are in mourning. It would be most unfriendly.
Well, will you go if I change my clothes?
As long as you don't take too long. I've never seen someone take so long getting dressed with such little results.
This bunburying, as you call it, has not been a great success for you.
Well, I believe it's been a great success. I'm in love with Cecily. And that is all.
I thought you were with Uncle Jack!
He's going to send me away.
They're about to part!
Yes, but before we do, I hope I shall not offend you if I state that you seem to be the visible personification of absolute perfection.
Thank you. Now, if you will bow, I will copy your remarks into my diary. Pray, Earnest, do not stop. I delight taking down dictation. I have reached absolute perfection. Pray, Earnest, do not cough. When one is dictating, one should speak fluently. Besides, I don't know how to spell a cough.
Cecily, ever since I looked upon your beauty, I have dared to love you wildly. Will you marry me?
You silly boy, of course! We have been engaged for the last 3 months.
The last 3 months?
Yes. Ever since dear Uncle Jack first confessed to me that he had a younger brother who was very wicked, I fell in love with you. Besides, there is a question of your name. You must not laugh at me. But it has always been a girl's dream of mine to love someone whose name was Earnest.
You mean you could not love me if I had some other name?
But what name?
Oh, well, any name will do. How about Algernon, for instance?
I might respect you, I might admire your character, but I don't think I should be able to give you my undivided attention. Oh. Besides, Earnest is your name.
Your rector here, I suppose, is all fluent in all rites of the church?
Oh, yes. Dr. Chasuble has never written a single book, so you can imagine how much he knows.
Cecily, I must be going away to important most important business. I shan't be away for more than half an hour.
But couldn't you make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back in no time.
Ah! What an impetuous boy he is! I must enter his proposal into my diary.
Miss Fairfax was just called to see Mr. Worthing.
Ask the lady to come here, and you may bring tea.
Yes, miss.
Miss Fairfax, I suppose one of the good, elderly women who is associated with Uncle Jack in some of his philanthropic work in London.
Miss Fairfax?
Hooray. Let me introduce myself. My name is Cecily Cardew.
Cecily Cardew, what a very sweet name. I like you already. And my first impressions are never wrong.
How nice you'd like me so much. Pray sit down.
I may call you Cecily, may I not?
With pleasure.
And you will always call me Gwendolyn, won't you?
If you wish.
Then it is all quite settled, is it not?
I hope so.
My mama, whose views on education are remarkably strict, has always brought me up to be rather short-sighted, so I hope you don't mind when looking at me through my glasses.
Oh, not at all. I'm very fond of being looked at.
You are here on some short visit, I suppose.
Oh, no, I live here.
Really, your mother, no doubt, resides here all year.
Oh, no, I have no mother, nor, in fact, any relationships. My guardian, with the assistance of Miss Prism, has the arduous task of looking after me.
Your guardian?
Yes, I am Mr. Worthing's ward.
Ernest never mentions me that he had a ward.
Hey, Gwendolyn, did you say Earnest?
Yes.
Oh, but it is not Earnest who is my guardian. It is his brother.
Earnest never mentioned to me that he had a brother. You are quite certain it is not Mr. Earnest who is your guardian.
Quite sure. In fact, I am going to be his
and I are engaged to be married.
There must be some slight misunderstanding. I am engaged to Mr. Worthing.
I'm afraid there is a misunderstanding. Earnest proposed to me exactly 10 minutes ago.
There must be some slight error, for Mr. Earnest Worthing asked me to be his wife yesterday afternoon at 5:30. I'm so sorry, dear Cecily, but I'm afraid I have the prior claim.
I feel bad to point out that since Earnest proposed to you, he clearly has changed his mind.
Shall I lay the tea here as usual, miss?
Yes, as usual.
Are there many interesting walks in the vicinity, Miss Cardew?
Oh yes, from the top of that hill you can see 5 counties.
I don't think I should like that. I hate crowds.
I suppose that's why you live in London.
Quite a well-kept garden you have, Miss Cardew. I had no idea there were any flowers in the country.
Oh, flowers here are as common as people are in London. May I offer you some tea? Sugar?
No, thank you. Sugar is not fashionable anymore.
Cake or bread and butter?
Bread and butter, please. Cake is rarely seen in the best houses.
Hand that to Miss Fairfax.
You fill my tea with lumps of sugar, and though I asked for bread and butter, you have given me cake. I warn you, Miss Cardew. You may go too far.
Save my poor, innocent, trusting boy, then know this which I do not go!
Earnest, my own Earnest.
Gwendolyn, darling.
A moment, Earnest. May I ask if you are to be engaged to this young lady?
Dear little Cecily, of course not.
Thank you. You may.
It's Earnest. A moment, Earnest. May I ask you, are you engaged to be married to this young lady?
Oh, to Gwendolyn? Of course I'm not engaged to Gwendolyn.
Thank you.
I felt that there must be some slight error. The gentleman whose arm you are now embracing is my cousin, Mr. Algernon Moncrief.
Algernon Moncrief! Are you called Algernon?
I cannot deny.
What is your name?
My name is John.
A gross deception has been practiced on both of us!
It is quite clear, dear Cecily, that neither of us is to be engaged to anyone.
Kindly answer me the following question, Mr. Moncrief. Why did you pretend to be my guardian's brother?
In order that I may have the opportunity of meeting you.
Mr. Worthing, what possible explanation can you offer to me for pretending to be Earnest? Was it in order that you might have an opportunity of coming up to town to see me?
You doubt it, Miss Fairfax?
Their explanations appear to be quite satisfactory.
I'm more than content.
Oh. But there are principles at stake that one cannot surrender. Which of us should talk one?
Could we not both speak at the same time?
What an excellent idea. I nearly always speak at the same time as other people. Will you take the time from me?
Your Christian names are still an inseparable barrier. That is all.
Our Christian names? Is that all? Or are we going to be Christian this afternoon?
For my sake, you are prepared to do this terrible thing.
For me, you're ready to face this fearful ordeal.
We are.
Darling.
Lady Bracknell.
Gwendolyn! What does this mean?
Merely that I'm engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Come here. Sit down. Sit down at once. Hesitation of any kind is a sign of mental decay in the young and a physical weakness in the old. A prize, sir, in my dog's sudden flight I've once followed by a luggage train. You will certainly understand that from this moment onward, all communication between yourself and my daughter will cease immediately. And now, let's arouse Algernon. Algernon!
Poor Bunbury died. The doctor said poor Bunbury cannot live, so Bunbury died.
You have considerable confidence in the opinion of his physicians. I'm glad, however, that he has made up his opinion to the last. And now, Mr. Worthing, may I ask you, who is this young lady whose hand my nephew Edmond seems to be holding in what seems to me to be a particularly unnecessary manner?
Well, that lady is Miss Cecily Carter, my ward.
I'm engaged to Cecily, Aunt Augusta.
I beg your pardon.
Mr. Moncrief and I are engaged to be married, Lady Bracknell.
I don't know if there's anything particularly exciting in the air of this particular part of Hertfordshire, but the amount of engagement set here on seems to me to be quite above the proper average. Some preliminary inquiry on my part might not be out of place. Mr. Worthing, may I ask if Miss Cardew has any connections at all to any of the larger railway stations of London?
Well, actually, Miss Cecily Cardew is the granddaughter of Mr. Thomas Cardew of 149 Belgrade Square. I also have in my possession the certificates of Miss Cardew's birth, baptism, whooping cough, registration, vaccination, confirmation, and the measles. Both the children in this
variety. Ah, a life-threatening incident. Has Miss Cardew any little fortune?
About £130,000 in the funds.
Ah, Miss Cardew is a rather attractive young lady, doesn't she? Come here. Your dress is sadly simple, and your hat seems to be about as major as you've left it. But we can alter all that. Well, I suppose I must give my consent.
I'm sorry, Lady Bracknell, but this marriage is entirely out of the question.
On what grounds do you object?
The matter is entirely in your own hands, Lady Bracknell. As soon as you consent to my marriage with Gwendolyn, I will happily allow your nephew to form an alliance with my ward.
Uncle Jack, please!
You must understand that what you propose is quite out of the question.
I have to say that everything is quite ready for the christenings.
The christenings? Is that not somewhat premature?
Both these gentlemen have expressed an immediate desire for baptism. Miss Prism and I have been waiting in the church.
Miss Prism? Did I hear you mention Miss Prism? Is this Miss Prism a female of somewhat repellent aspect?
She is the most cultivated of ladies and the very picture of respectability.
It is obviously the same person. Let her be sent for at once.
She approaches. She is now.
Dear Aunt Chasuble, I was wondering what was detaining you.
Prism! Prism! 28 years ago, you left the house of Lord Bracknell with a perambulator containing a male child. You never returned. Weeks later, the perambulator was found, containing a manuscript of a work of fiction, but the baby was nowhere to be seen. Prism! Where is that baby?
Lady Bracknell, I do not know. I only wish I did. The facts are these. On the morning you mentioned, I had prepared to take the baby out of the perambulator. I had also with me a somewhat old yet capacious handbag in which I had intended to place a manuscript of fiction I had written. In a moment of mental abstraction, I placed the manuscript and the bassinet and the baby in the handbag.
Where did you deposit the handbag?
Do not ask me, Mr. Worthing.
Miss Prism, this matter is of no small importance to me. Where did you deposit the handbag that contained the baby?
I left it in one of the larger railway stations of London.
Which line?
Victoria, the Fresno line.
I must retire to the next room for a moment. Gwendolyn, you will wait here for me.
What do you think this means, Lady Bracknell?
I can hardly guess, but I don't need to tell you that in families of high regard, strange coincidences are not supposed to occur.
Miss Prism. Is this the handbag?
Yes, it appears to be mine. Yes, here's the injury it received through a Gower Street omnibus upsetting of earlier days. Here on the lock are my initials. Bag's undoubtedly mine. I am delighted to have it restored to me. It's been a great inconvenience being without it all of these years.
Miss Prism, more is restored to you than just the handbag. I was the baby you placed inside of it.
You?
Yes, mother.
Mr. Worthing, I am unmarried! There's the woman who can tell you who you really are.
Lady Bracknell, I hate to seem inquisitive, but could you kindly inform me as to who I am?
The news I have to give you may not be entirely to your satisfaction. You are the son of my poor sister, Mrs. Moncrief, and consequently, Algernon's elder brother.
Algernon's elder brother? Then I have a brother after all.
But what is your Christian name now that you have become someone else?
Lady Bracknell, at the time Miss Prism had left me in the handbag, had I already been christened? What was my name? Let me know the words.
He and the child were naturally christened after your father.
What was his Christian name?
Lily recall what the general's Christian name was. I have no doubt he had one. He was eccentric, I must admit, but only in the later years.
Algy, do you remember what our father's other name was?
He died before we were even on speaking terms. He died before I was even a year old.
His name would appear in the army list of the period. Oh, yes, the army list lasts 14 years a year. These records should have been my constant study.
Oh my.
Let's see here. M. Generals. Malum. Maxbum. Magley. What ghastly names they have. Moncrief. Lieutenant, 1840. Captain. Lieutenant Colonel. Colonel. General, 1869. Christian names. Ernest John. I've always told you, Gwendolyn, my name was Ernest. Well, I mean, it is Ernest. I mean, it naturally is Ernest.
My own Ernest. I felt from the first that you have no other name.
Gwendolyn, it's a terrible thing for a man to find out that he's been speaking nothing but the truth all his life.
Frederick, at last! Cecily, at last!
Gwendolyn, at last!
My nephew seems to be displaying signs of triviality.
On the contrary, Aunt Augusta, I realized for the first time in my life the vital importance of being Ernest.
Thank you all so much for coming, and we'll see you next time.